عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، ولا تقولوا لمن ألقى إليكم السلام لست مؤمنا، وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ثلاث من أصل الإيمان: الكف عمن قال لا إله إلا الله، ولا تكفره بذنب، ولا تخرجه من الإسلام بعمل. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: إذا قال الرجل لأخيه يا كافر فقد باء بها أحدهما، فإن كان كما قال وإلا رجع عليه، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. My dear brothers and respected elders, we begin in the name of Allah and praise Him and glorify Him and thank Him for everything He's given us. We seek His forgiveness and we ask Him to send His infinite mercy upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sent as a blessing and as rahmat and as a guide to the whole of mankind. And we ask Allah to enlighten our hearts with His love for His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, love for our fellow Muslim brethren, so that we may all live like Muslims and die like Muslims and rise like Muslims on the day of Qiyamah. My dear brothers, this ummah is a very special ummah. We are all part and parcel of the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The ummah which was prayed for by Ibrahim Khalilullah alayhi salatu wa taslim. He said, Ya Allah, Ya Rabbana waj'alna muslimain laka wa min dhurriyatina ummatan muslimatan laka. From my offspring, Ya Allah, raise an ummah which will be obedient to you. And for the benefit and the guidance of that ummah, raise a prophet. Allah made that prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this ummah, Ibrahim alayhi salam, named it Huwa Sammakumul Muslimin. Name this ummah Muslimin. Allah refers to them in the Quran as the best ummah, khayra ummatin, the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the beloved Prophet of Allah, Khatamun Nabiyeen, Rahmatul Lil Alameen, Sayyidul Awwaleen wal Akhireen. Not just our Prophet, not just our Nabi, he is Nabiyul Anbiya, and the Nabi of all the Prophets, their Imam. Rasulullah, the best of the teachers, and the best of the Prophets. He strove and made effort and struggled to build this ummah, not overnight, over a period of 23 years. He instilled love and brotherhood into the hearts and minds and souls of every Muslim at the time. Allah said, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. O you mu'mins, you are brothers. The Prophet said, كُونُوا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ إِخْوَانًا. O you servants of Allah, become brothers. Become brothers. Treat one another in a good way. Like for each other what you like for yourselves. لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يُحِبُّ لِأَخِيهِ مَا يُحِبُّ لِنَفْسِهِ. No one can be a true believer unless and until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. Not only should you love for your brothers what you love for yourselves, you should keep your hearts clean for your brothers as well. Allah has taught us a wonderful dua in the Quran, which the believers recite. رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلِإِخْوَانِنَا الَّذِينَ سَبَقُونَا بِالْإِيمَانِ. Ya Allah, forgive us and forgive our brethren who've gone before us. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Ya Allah, do not create, do not allow any malice in our hearts for any of the people who believe. A Muslim's heart should be clean for another Muslim. A Muslim should treat another Muslim as a brother. And if a person can't do that, that means his heart isn't lit with the noor of Iman. If he had any noor of Iman in his heart, he wouldn't look down upon anyone. He would love for the others what he loves for himself. He would have immense respect for other Muslims. But we are living in very difficult times, times of fitan and fasad. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prophesied coming of such times. In many ahadith, if you pick up books of ahadith, there are chapters dedicated to such difficult times of fitan and fasad. Now when people, Allahu Akbar, the Prophet said, Ata ala ummati, يأتي على أمتي كما أتى على بني إسرائيل حذو النعل بالنعل. There will come a time upon my ummah like there was a time upon the Bani Israel. Just as one shoe is a total reflection of the other. If you take a pair of shoes and from the soles you put them on top of each other, how one shoe fits totally on top of the other. The Prophet said, similarly, my ummah will follow in the footsteps of Bani Israel to such an extent, hatta in kana minhum man ata ummahu alaniyatan, if there was any man in them who disgraced, humiliated, shamed himself openly with his mother, you know what that means? If someone humiliated, put himself to shame in the public with his own mother, the Prophet said, لَكَانَ فِي أُمَّتِي مَنْ يَصْنَعُ ذَلِكَ. There will definitely be a man in this ummah who will commit the same shame. So much they will follow. وَإِنَّ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ تَفَرَّقَتْ عَلَىٰ ثِنَتَيْنِ وَسَبْعِينَ مِلَّةً. Bani Israel were divided into 72 sects. And this ummah will go one step further into 73 sects. There will come a time, الرَّجُلُ يَبِيعُ دِينَهُ بِأَرَضٍ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا. People will sell their iman for a meager worldly gain. يُصْبِحُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُمْسِحُ كَافِرًا وَيُمْسِحُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُصْبِحُ كَافِرًا. Be Muslim in the morning, kafir by the evening. Muslim in the evening, kafir by the morning. We are going through such times. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَكْثُرُ الْجَهَلُ. There will come a time, ignorance will become common. They say common sense. Common sense isn't common anymore. Ignorance will become common. Knowledge will become scarce. Allah will lift ulama. When Allah wants to remove knowledge from people, Allah doesn't. You know, you won't see books vanishing just like that. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ إِنْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ الْعِبَادِ. Allah doesn't remove knowledge by taking knowledge away from the hearts and minds of people. That today you knew something, now nobody knows it anymore. وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاء. Allah takes knowledge away by taking ulama away. People of knowledge. حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يَبْقَى عَالِمًا. Until there will come a time, they will not remain a single alim. And ilm isn't just what you can learn and memorize words and phrases. True knowledge is what penetrates the heart and then changes your life and it governs your practice. That is real knowledge. Otherwise, if it's just in the mind, that is hujjah upon you. I'm not saying knowledge is bad, knowledge is good through and through. But the purpose of knowledge is to change and affect your heart and to put you on the right path. And if it doesn't, then you haven't acquired knowledge. And it should lead you to the fear of Allah. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاء. Sign of real scholars, those who fear Allah. Fear in Arabic is a wonderful language. Very precise language. It's for no reason. It isn't for no reason that Allah has made. And the Quran in Arabic, the language of Rasulullah is Arabic. The language of Jannah will be Arabic. Don't ask me what is the language of Jahannam. The language of Jannah, Arabic. Language of Rasulullah, Arabic. Language of Quran, Arabic. The word khashya generally translated as fear, but there is fear of two kinds. One is a fear when you fear someone, you run away. Allah forbid if there was an enormous snake here or a lion here and started roaring, everybody will run. That's a fear. When you're scared of something, you run away. There is another fear, and that is a fear when you fear someone, then you run towards them. You run towards them. Where can we run from Allah? Any place in the universe where we can hide from Allah? And so Allah says, don't run away from Allah, run towards Allah. فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. Run towards Allah. Have you ever seen 2-3-year-old children when the mother beats them? What do? Run away? The more the mother hits, the more they cling to the mother. Now this is khashya. The more a person knows Allah, the more he runs towards Allah. He doesn't want to make Allah angry. This is khashya. This is in ulama. Innama yakhsha Allah min ibadi al-ulama. If a person has such khashya, he seeks the pleasure of Allah. He runs towards Allah. He is a real man of knowledge. Otherwise, if a person doesn't fear Allah, doesn't obey Allah, he knows a lot of words and phrases and sentences, and then the knowledge hasn't penetrated his heart. And Allah says in the Quran, وَأَدَلَّهُ اللَّهُ وَلَا عِلْمُ. This is not a da'if hadith from Fazal-e Amal. This is a verse of the Quran. Quran. But people don't read Quran. They just carry Bukhari under their armpits. But brother, this is in Bukhari. Allahu Akbar. Now this is Quran. Quran. إِنَّمَا يَوَعَدَ اللَّهُ اللَّهُ وَلَا عِلْمٍ. When people follow their own desires, they think they are good. Shaitan didn't have knowledge. Shaitan had plenty of knowledge. But then why did he become a kafir? Allah misled him. In spite of his knowledge, أَبَا وَاسْتَكْبَرَ وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. His arrogance led him to kufr. So arrogance, Allahu Akbar, may Allah save us all, leads a person to kufr. He'll become a kafir in spite of knowledge and knowing. Allah will mislead him. Allah will seal his heart. وَخَتَمَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ وَعَلَىٰ سَمِهِ وَبَصَرِهِ. Allah will seal his heart. Allah will put curtains upon his eyes. Allah will seal his ears. He can't hear the truth even. He can't see the truth. He can't understand the truth. So knowledge is what penetrates the heart, leads a person close to Allah. And these are such times, such knowledge is becoming scarce. Allah is taking such ulama away who are cautious, who are careful, who are mindful, who feared Allah and obeyed Allah properly. حتى إذا لم يبقى عالما, there will not remain a single such عالم. اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا. People will take ignorant people to be their leaders. فأضلّ. And then such people, فأفتوا بغير علم فضلوا وأضلوا. They will give fatwas and rulings without knowledge because they are misled themselves, they will mislead others. They will give fatwas. I often refer to them as mufti min al-mufti. You know, there is a mufti who's sought knowledge 9-10 years, mashallah, gone to madrasa, memorized the Quran, learned from scholars, mashallah. He's been given permission to give fatwa. He's a proper mufti. There are others, mashallah, don't know anything, can't recite Fatiha properly, but he'll give you a fatwa. He's a mufti min al-mufti, freestyle mufti. And there's plenty of them about nowadays, mashallah. And they give such heavy-duty fatwas. Allahu Akbar, enough to shake the arsh of Allah. Allahu Akbar, to make Allah angry in such a way. Allah, Sahaba would never ever dare give such fatwas as you get people flashing these fatwas around left, right, and center. Mufti min al-mufti. Allahu Akbar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Talakum min asl al-Iman. Hadith reported by Imam Abu Dawood in his collection. There are three things, they are fundamentals of Iman. If you had an Iman in your heart, you will be mindful of these three things. Thalathum min asl al-Iman. Al-kaffu amman qala la ilaha illallah. Whosoever says la ilaha illallah, you should hold your tongue and hand away from him. Don't raise your hand and tongue against a man who says la ilaha illallah. MashaAllah, brothers gathered here. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of the preachers. When the Prophet was in Makkatul Mukarramah, 14 years, Rasulullah used to preach, go house to house, street to street. Very few people would listen to him. And the people would say, قَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَا تَسْمَعُوا لِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. Don't listen to this Quran. وَالْغَوْفِ. When they recite it, make a noise. Don't let them listen to it properly. But Rasulullah gathered, oh, you people, come here, I want to tell you about Allah. Mafhoom. Abu Lahab got up and said, تَبَّلْ لَكَ يَا مُحَمَّدْ أَلِهَذَا جَمَعْتَنَا. Woe be to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is this why you gathered us to tell us you're Rasulullah? Allah said, تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ. Rasulullah would go 14 years almost in Makkah. Very few people used to listen. He made hijrah to Medina. Medina wasn't a big town like London, like Medina is now. population of a few thousand. And there were different sort of areas, hay we call them, mahalle in Urdu. And people had their own little masajid in their mahallas, in their small towns. People used to come to Masjid al-Nabawi mostly for Jummah and from neighboring villages as well. So given any time with Rasulullah, used to be maximum 100, 200 people usually around him. Rasulullah would give, when you see the hadith of Rasulullah, what Rasulullah himself has spoken, few words, a few lines. Rasulullah didn't used to give very large, very long lectures. When after another 10 years, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made Hajjatul Wida, and Islam had spread all over Arabia, the Prophet sent people around to tell the people to gather around at Hajj, because Rasulullah will be performing Hajj. So everybody came. MashaAllah, when Hajj season comes, people want to go with a good sheikh or with a good group. Can you imagine doing with Hajj with Rasulullah? Praying behind Rasulullah? What an honor. Everybody came. Anybody who was a Muslim could come. Everybody came. You know how many people turned up? Almost 100,000. More than 100,000. This was only one opportunity Rasulullah had in his entire life. Only one opportunity to address such a large gathering. 100,000 plus people. Had it been someone like me or some modern sheikh or mufti min al-mufti, he would have gone on endlessly, mashallah. If you go to Hajj, may Allah take us all again and again. In Arafah, in places, mashallah, many groups, they take mashayikh, and mashallah, they give long lecture, mashallah, an hour, sometime an hour and a half. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khatimun nabiyyin, Rasulullah said at the beginning, oh people, perhaps next year I won't be here. In other words, many of you will never see me again even. I won't see you again. So at such a time, you would have thought Rasulullah would address them and pump them as much as he can. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first and the last opportunity he ever had to address such a large gathering. You know what the Prophet said? Oh you people, what month is this? What place is this? What day is this? People said, Ya Rasulullah, it's a day of Arafah, plain of Arafah, month of Al-Hajjah. The Prophet said, oh you people, listen, understand. Allah has made the honor and wealth of every Muslim haram upon you. Like hurmati yawmikum hadha fi baladikum hadha fi shahrikum hadha. Just as this day is sacred, in this special month, in this special place, oh you Muslims, similarly the honor and wealth of other Muslim is haram upon you. Don't insult another Muslim. Don't abuse another Muslim. Don't look down upon another Muslim. Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadi. A true Muslim is he from whose tongue and hands other Muslims feel safe. They know they're with their brother. If another Muslim isn't safe with you, from your hand or from your tongue, there's seriously something wrong with your Iman and your Islam. Otherwise, a Muslim with another Muslim, how can he feel unsafe? The one and only opportunity Rasulullah had to address his ummah, 100,000 plus. He didn't give them tafsir, he didn't teach them aqidah, he didn't teach them sahih hadith, daif hadith, Bukhari and the rest. He talked about the importance of love for other Muslims, unity, looking after one another, caring for one another, not hurting, insulting, abusing one another. And you know another thing he talked about? Another thing he talked about, and usually you can get the last, it's called the farewell sermon of Rasulullah. It's a gist, summary of the Prophet's lifetime mission, summarized on one page. And you know what else Rasulullah said? Oh you people, be mindful of your women. Be careful, be cautious about them. أَخَذْتُمُوهُنَّ بِأَمَانِ اللَّهِ وَاسْتَحْلَلْتُمْ فُرُوجَهُنَّ بِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ. You made them lawful for yourselves with Allah's word. You've taken them into your lives with Allah's permission. Be mindful of them. The rights of women, being good to them. You know, just as Rasulullah said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ The best amongst you are those who learn and teach Qur'an. Similarly, Rasulullah said, خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ The best amongst you are those who are good with their families, with their wives. With their wives, being good to you. Muslims are not supposed to be wife bashers. And people think, oh, man, Allahu Akbar. Go home and beat your wife. Astaghfirullah. Rasulullah said, how can a man beat his wife during the day and sleep with her at night? Kaun se muh ke saath din ko marta hai, raat ko uske saath sota hai. How can you do that? Muslims are not meant to be wife bashers. Muslims are meant to take care of their wives, take care of their folk, of their children. If there is any such man, he thinks this is Islam. This is not Islam. This is his arrogance, rather his ignorance and pride. So the Prophet said, ثَلَاثٌ مِّنْ أَصْلِ الْإِيمَانِ Three things, they are part of your iman. First thing, الْكَفْوَ مَّنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ Whosoever says, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ Hold your hands and your tongue back from him. وَلَا تُكَفِّرُهُ بِذَنْبِهِ And don't you dare call him a kafir because of his sin. No matter what he's doing, he's committing a sin. Sinful action, bad action, shameful action. But don't call him a kafir because of his sin. Who are we to look down upon people because of their sin? When Allah, who's actually the judge and the Lord and the master, he will decide. Luckily, you and I won't decide who will go to Jannah. Although many people think they've got the contract from Allah to fill Jahannam, Allah will fill it himself. Allah will decide, alhamdulillah, who will go to Jannah and who will go to Jahannam. Allah says, Inna Rabbaka huwa yafsilu baynahum yawm al-qiyamah fima kanu fihi ikhtalifun. Allah will be the judge on the day of Qiyamah. All your differences, wa inna Rabbaka la yahkumu baynakum yawm al-qiyamah. Allah will decide on the day of Qiyamah who was really on the right path. Inna Rabbaka huwa a'lamu biman dhalla an sabili wa huwa a'lamu bil muhtadin. Allah knows who's really on the right path and the wrong path. So leave these matters to Allah. Don't take measures in your own hand. Wala tukaffiruhu bidhanbin. How sinful. Doesn't matter how shameful a person might be conducting himself. Don't pass rulings and judgments upon them. When Allah says, Qul ya ibadi alladhina asrafu ala anfusihim. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا. Oh, you people who wronged yourselves, don't despair in the hope of Allah. Allah will forgive all your sins. This is in the Quran and in Hadith Qudsi. Hadith Qudsi is a hadith which Rasulullah said, Allah says. Allah speaks to people through Rasulullah. Quran is the message of Allah in the words of Allah. Sometimes Rasulullah conveyed Allah's message but his own words. Hadith Qudsi reported by Imam Tirmizi. Imam Nabawi rahmahullah has also narrated this in Riyad al-Salihin. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah says, Yabna Adam, O you son of Adam, Innaka ma da'utani wa rajautani ghafartu laka ala ma kana minka wala ubali. O you son of Adam, as long as you keep turning to me, you have hope in me. Don't worry, I'll forgive you. Your forgiving you doesn't bother me. إِنَّكَ مَا دَعُوتَنِي وَرَجَوْتَنِي غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنْكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي Don't worry about your sins don't do me any harm. يَا بْنَ آدَمْ لَوْ بَلَغَتْ ذُنُوبُكَ عَنَانَ السَّمَاءِ Oh, you son of Adam, if your sins were to pile up to the heavens, ثُمَّ اسْتَغْفَرْتَنِي And then you were to seek forgiveness from me, Allah says, غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنْكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي O son of Adam, don't worry, these things don't bother me. Your sins piling up to the heavens, no problem for me. Ya ibn Adam, as long as when you come to me, لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا لا تشرك بي شيئا. When you come to me with your sins equivalent to the grain of sand, providing you haven't committed shirk, Allah says, لا أتيتك بقرابها مغفرة. I will welcome you with even more forgiveness. As long as you haven't committed shirk, Allah says, your sins don't bother me. Rasulullah said, don't try and throw a man out of the fold of Islam because you see him sinning. He's doing something wrong. He's not behaving properly. His behavior might be sinful, might be bad, might be shameful, but don't throw him out of Islam because of that. When a child is covered in filth, got diarrhea, he's covered in filth, he's smelling, stinking, does the mother throw him away? What does she do? She cleans the nappy, she washes him, and she says, Mera putter, mera sona. My darling, my hubby bubby. Allahu Akbar. Don't look down upon a Muslim and throw him away because you see him misbehaving. The Prophet said, وَلَا تُكَفِّرُهُ بِذَنْبٍ وَلَا تُخْرِجُهُ مِنَ الْإِسْلَامِ بِعَمَلٍ. Doesn't matter what he's doing, his action. We're talking about actions here. Whatever he's doing, misbehaving, you might see him drinking, you might see him eating pork, you might see him gambling, he's not praying, but merely because of these things, don't call him a kafir. These things don't make a person kafir. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, and this hadith is reported by Imam Bukhari and by Imam Muslim. Imam Nawawi rahmahullah in Riyad al-Salihin dedicated a whole chapter to this issue. Bab tahreem qawluhu li muslim ya kafir. A chapter on why it is haram to call another Muslim kafir. And he says, Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, they have reported a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Iza qala rajulu li akhihi ya kafir. Allahu Akbar. When Rasulullah said, when a man calls his brother, oh kafir, he should have called him what? He should have called him, Rasulullah said, إِذَا قَالَ الرَّجُلُ لِأَخِيهِ. When a man calls his brother a kafir, he should have called him brother. But instead he's calling him a kafir. إِذَا قَالَ الرَّجُلُ لِأَخِيهِ يَا كَافِر. The Prophet said, فَقَدْ بَاءَ بِهَا أَحَدُهُمَا. It becomes binding upon one of them. So when a man says to another man, oh, you kafir. So either he's a kafir or he's a kafir. One of them is definitely a kafir. فَقَدْ بَاءَ بِهَا أَحَدُهُمَا. فَإِنْ كَانَ كَمَا قَالَ. If he is really a kafir, the man you're calling a kafir, if he is a kafir, okay, you say. But if it's not, وَإِلَّا رَجَعَ عَلَيْهِ. Then don't worry, brother. That kufr is coming straight back at you. That kufr will come back to haunt you. And there is a danger when you die, because you look down upon other Muslims as kafir, there is a danger when you die, Allahu Akbar, you might die as a kafir yourself. Rasulullah in another hadith, again reported by Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, من دعا رجلا بالكفر أو قال عدو الله. Whenever any man calls another person, من دعا رجلا بالكفر أو كافر أو عدو الله, or an enemy of Allah. You know, like many people, they say, oh Allah ke dushman, oh enemy of Allah. Don't call any Muslim an enemy of Allah. A Muslim isn't an enemy of Allah. A Muslim is a friend of Allah. Allah waliyul ladina amanu. Allah is a friend of all the believers. So let a friend remain a friend. Don't turn a friend into an enemy. من دعا رجلا بالكفر أو قال عدو الله وليس كذلك. And that is not the case. He is not a kafir. He is not an enemy of Allah. Rasulullah said, إلا حار عليه. أي رجع عليه. In other words, just wait. He's coming straight back at you. It will come back to haunt you. Calling another Muslim a kafir, such a severe sin, it can come back to haunt a person. Allahu Akbar. Sahaba went in the path of Allah. They came across a village. There was a shepherd grazing some sheep. And they approached him. And when he saw them, he said, Assalamu alaikum. Ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. He welcomed them. He said, Assalamu alaikum. I testify there's no God other than Allah, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. The Sahabi took out his sword and beheaded him. They came and they took their sheep. They came back to Rasulullah, reported the issue. Rasulullah said, did you look into his heart? They said, Ya Rasulullah, he did it out of fear. He didn't really mean it. The Prophet said, did you jump into his heart and see? He was saying it out of fear. How dare you kill another Muslim? How dare you say that? And then Allah sent down Jibreel, go down, tell him. ولا تقولوا لمن ألقى إليكم السلام لست مؤمنا. Don't say to another person who makes salam to you, you are not a Muslim. Who are you to judge? How can you say you are not a Muslim? You have no right to say that. You have no right to call another Muslim a kafir. Unfortunately, sadly, not just another man on the street. It's become, it's everybody, you got nothing but, oh, he's a kafir. People calling Muslim scholars kafir. The greatest of the scholars, people calling them kafir. Allahu Akbar. And 2 years ago, there was a conference in Birmingham, supposed graduate of Medina University spoke about Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah and called him every conceivable insult. Every conceivable insult, and condemning him to kufr without plainly using those words. If anybody's got a phone, you can ask me after the lecture. I will send you a text message, a link to a lecture recorded in Jeddah by a Pakistani by the name of Rana Shamshad Salafi. And he's comparing Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah to being worse than Musaylimah Kadhab. Musaylimah Kadhab, you know who Musaylimah Kadhab was? He was a man in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He declared nubuwwat and he sent the letter to Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, that I am prophet for the villages, you are a prophet for the cities, let us come to a compromise. Rasulullah rejected all his offers, sent him away. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, under the leadership of Khalid ibn Walid, sent an army to deal with him and kill him. Wahshi radiallahu anhu, the same person who killed Hazrat Hamza in this campaign, killed Musaylimah Kadhab as well. He's referred to as Kadhab, the greatest liar. And the man who claimed to be a Nabi in the time of Rasulullah, this Rana Shamshad Salafi, has the nerve to record a program when he came for Umrah in Jeddah, and then he went and he said, Abu Hanifa did what Musaylimah Kadhab couldn't even do. And people left, right and center, oh, kafir, mushrik, bit shirk. So if a person is committing shirk, the person who's committing a shirk, what does he become? He becomes a kafir, he becomes a mushrik. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ. Anyone who commits shirk, Allah has made Jannah haram upon that person. So if he can't go to Jannah, where is he going? He's definitely coming to Jahannam. Have you got the contract to fill Jahannam? So if a person thinks he's a mushrik, don't worry brother, it's coming back to haunt you. It will come back to haunt you. One of the greatest saints, scholars, muhaddisun of modern times was a sheikh called Maulana Zakaria Rahmatullahi Alayhi. He's written a wonderful book, it's entitled Fadail Amal. It's read almost in every masjid throughout the world. And sheikh has written many things in there. Many people, oh, burn this book. Why, it's full of fabricated ahadith and daif hadith and fabricated stories. So burn this book. There is not a single narration Maulana Zakaria Rahmatullahi Alayhi has presented from himself. There are hundreds of verses of Quran, stories of Sahaba from Bukhari, Muslim, other books of Hadith, and if there are daif hadiths, Imam Maulana Zakaria Rahmatullahi Alayhi hasn't fabricated, made up a single narration himself, taken them from Tirmizi, Abu Dawud, Nisai, Ibn Majah, Abu Yala, Darimi, Ibn Hibban, Tahawi, all the books of Ahadith. So if a person says, burn this book, he should go and first burn Tirmizi, Abu Dawud, Nisai, Ibn Majah, and all the other books of Hadith, because this has been compiled from them. And in any case, whether a Hadith is da'if or whatever, there isn't a single hadith anywhere in the universe about which a person can prove from the Quran or hadith of the Prophet that the Prophet said this is he or daif. This is the opinion of ulama. Many hundred years down the line, they laid down conditions, and in their opinion, if something was not quite up to what they thought best, okay, then they classified them into different
categories. This classification is their opinion. It's not in the Quran. Rasulullah didn't say it. Hence, ulama have been accepting Zaif hadiths and narrations, mashallah, in their compilations. Imam Bukhari hasn't brought Zaif hadiths in his Sahih, but in other books, Adab al-Mufrid, Tariq Kabir, Imam Bukhari has presented hundreds of Zaif hadiths. So you should first go and burn the work of Imam Bukhari before opening your mouth against Fazail-e Amal. When people say these things, they don't know what they are saying. They don't know what they are implying. And then, Hazrat Shaykh Al-Hadees Rahmatullah Alayhi, you know, when people make statements, people don't understand even what statement is being made. They become mufti min al-muft without understanding the issue, the subject, the matter, the statement. They jump to conclusions. Wow, man, that is blatant kufr, shirk, man. This guy is a mushrik. Maulana Zakariya Rahmatullah Alayhi has written in Fazail-e Sadaqat while describing the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As a Shaykh al-Hadith Rahmatullah Alayhi, and as a Shaykh al-Hadith was one of the greatest muhaddith of recent times. He wasn't in his lifetime known so much in the Arab world, but all the Muslims are not Arabs. All the Muslims are not Arabs. In fact, more than 50%, almost 60, if I was to say 70% even, then inshallah I won't be wrong, more than 70% of Muslims are non-Arabs. Just in three countries, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, just in these three countries, more than 50% of the Ummah is just only in these three countries. You put in Indonesia next to them, that's more than 70%. Saudi Arabia, 15, 20 million. Egypt, 50, 60 million. Also, Tunisia, Algeria. Put all the Arabs together, around 200 million. In India alone, there are 300 million Muslims. MashaAllah. So just because somebody wasn't known in the Arab world doesn't mean he wasn't a sheikh. He taught Bukhari for 50 years. 50 years he taught Bukhari. Allahu Akbar. And the books of hadith, many of his students are grand scholars, mashallah. His only thing is he didn't have petrodollars, that's all. So he could advertise himself, mashallah. But otherwise, Shaykh al-Hadees rahimahullah, one of the grand scholars of the recent times, he's written about the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that the place where Rasulullah is resting, that place is more noble than the Kaaba. The sand touching Rasulullah, his noble body. That sand, that place upon which Rasulullah is resting is more noble than the Kaaba, even the Arsh of Allah. How dare Maulana Zakariya say what kufr, shirk, nonsense? They don't know that Maulana Zakariya hasn't said this himself. He's only copying what another grand scholar has written before. So if a person is going to label Maulana Zakariya kafir, mushrik because of this statement, then he should be prepared to label Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, the student of Ibn Taymiyyah, because he's written the same statement in his book 800 years ago. But because Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah is highly respected in Salafi circles, they won't open their mouth against him. But Maulana Zakariya has narrated the same thing from him. They label him as a mushrik and a kafir. Leave him alone. Don't talk about him. So if this issue is kufr, then so does Ibn Qayyim fall into the same category. So if you're going to label someone a kafir because of a concept, then anybody who falls, why don't you put the same ruling upon them? Many people don't understand what people have said. They don't have a clue what's being said, but they are very, very quick to pass fatwas. And their brother, one jamaat went into a masjid somewhere in London. This is a few days ago. They were getting ready on a Thursday evening to go to Markaz. Brother, where are you going? Brother, there's a gathering in Old Gate East, mashallah. Brothers gather together, they talk about deen. Oh, brother, there is no evidence Thursday evening gatherings in the Quran and Sunnah is bid'ah.
Okay, brother, so how do you expect me to learn deen?
Brother, come to our halaqa.
When is your halaqa? On a Sunday.
Is there dalil, any evidence to have a halaqa on a Sunday? If having a halaqa gathering is a bid'ah on a Thursday, then where is the evidence for a Sunday? But if anything, there is evidence in Bukhari, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu used to hold a gathering for his students every Thursday. This is in Bukhari. But if only he read Bukhari, he only carries Bukhari under his armpit.
Allahu Akbar.
So to label people as kafirs and mushriks and bidah. Brother, you know, these 3 days are over, where does it come from? You've got to learn your aqidah first. Aqidah. Without aqidah, nothing is valid. Brother, can you show me the word aqidah in the Quran? Did Rasulullah say learn aqidah? Any hafiz sitting here? Put your hands up if you're hafiz, brothers. Anybody read the Quran, hafiz? Any hafiz here? Brother, does the word aqidah come in Quran? Allah hasn't used the word aqidah even once in the Quran. There isn't a single hadith anywhere, sahih or da'if, or even fabricated for that issue, in which Rasulullah said, learn aqidah. So a terminology Allah hasn't used, Rasulullah hasn't used, and that's the first step, that's the starting. Brother, you got to learn your aqidah. Brother, show me the word aqidah in the Quran, and any sahih hadith I will use. I'm willing, I'll take you as my sheikh. MashaAllah. What does the use? What does Allah refer to in the Quran and Hadith? Allah says, يؤمنون بالآخرة يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون. The word Allah uses throughout the Quran is إيمان and يقين. إيمان and يقين. إيمان and يقين. And brother, aqidah. Aqidah is the most important thing. Brother, show me the word aqidah just once in the once only in the Quran. There isn't in the Quran. Show me from the noble tongue and lips of Rasulullah in any Zaif hadith even. I will take you as my sheikh. But Rasulullah didn't say it. And from any Sahabi anywhere, they never use the word aqidah. So if a word, terminology is a problem, many brothers, mashallah, you know, in the Quran, there is a term tazkiyah. Tazkiyah means purification. Purification of the heart. Purification of the nafs. There is nothing so important in the Quran as tazkiyah. The tazkiyah is the sunnah of Allah, that wherever Allah mentions anything in the Quran which is important, then Allah does so with a qasam. You know, like we say something, brother, I did this. No, no, don't tell me, man. No, wallahi, brother, I did this, man. So we say it with a qasam, saying, I swear by Allah. Whatever Allah says is haq anyway. Allah is haq. Every word Allah has spoken is haq. Anything to do with Allah is haq. Allah is haq. His word is haq. His promise is haq. But if Allah hadn't said any qasam, no problem. Word of Allah, who can be more? Man astaqu min Allah qila. Who can be more truthful than Allah? But when there is a serious issue, you know what Allah does? Allah takes a qasam. In some places, one qasam like Suratul Asr. Asr, I swear by time. Ya Allah, why do you need to swear? Allah knows we don't listen. We need to say wallahi. Unless Allah says that wallahi, Allah knows people won't be convinced. So Allah uses the qasam to convince us. Allah says, wal asri, I swear by time, by the word. Inna al-insana lafi khusr. Oh, you people, you're all at a loss. With anything, Hassan, leave it, man. Hassan, leave it. Don't worry about it, man. Just, inshallah, let them be. Just relax, inshallah. Don't worry. We thodi si pyaas bhi lagni chahiye na. Zor to sara main laga raha hu, pani aap pee rahe hain. Wal asri. Allah says, I swear by time, the whole humanity is at a loss. Very crucial issue. It's a matter of your success or failure. One qasam. Imam Shafi Rahimahullah used to say, if there was no other surah, only this surah, this would have been sufficient for in place of the whole Quran. One qasam. Another place is Allah says, four qasams, three qasam, wateen, wazaytun, watur sinin, wahad al balad al amin. In one place, Allah takes seven qasams.
How many?
Seven.
Seven قسمز. So جس بات کو اللہ نے سات قسمیں کھا کر بیان کیا وہ معمولی بات ہوگی. Something Allah mentions with seven قسمز, you think it's a trivial issue? Kufar issue? To make you a kafir?
والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما تحاها ونفس وما سواها.
How many قسمز?
Seven
قسمز. And then Allah says قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها. Whosoever purifies his nafs, he is succeeded. Whosoever doesn't, he's doomed. Purification of the nafs is so crucial, so critical, so important, so that you think good, you desire good, you wish good, you clean through and through. Not just have a nice bath with head and shoulders and Palmolive or Lux, mashallah, you come smelling all nice and fresh, that's nice. But your heart needs to be clean as well. Your nafs needs to be clean as well. This is referred to as tazkiyah. With the passage of time, people enhanced this field and started calling it tasawwuf. Tasawwuf means purification as well. A word with a similar meaning. So a person, mashallah, who follows the path of tasawwuf is known as a Sufi. Just like Rasulullah has been given three responsibilities in the Quran. How many? يَتْلُوَ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Recite Allah's verses, purify the people, and teach them the book and wisdom. Tilawat, recite Allah's verses. Did Rasulullah teach people Quran or not? Hazur ne Quran padhaya hai, sikhaya nahi sikhaya? The Prophet teach. Did the Prophet ever in any hadith anywhere, did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ever have a class of children and say, Ali zabara, ba zabar ba, ta zabar ta? بھی حضور نے کبھی ایسے بھی کسی بچے کو خود سکھایا ہے؟ Did the Prophet ever teach any child Ali Fatha Aba, Fatha Bata, Fatha Ta? Kisi sunne? No, he didn't. The Arabs were Arabs, they spoke Arabic, but mashallah, and they were grown up, sensible, mature, they were chosen people to be in the company of Rasulullah. Rasulullah didn't have to do that. But he taught them Quran. But now, Qari Abdul Basit, when he started, Sheikh Sudais, when he started, Sheikh Mahir, when he started, Shuraim, when he started, any Qari who started, Maulana Qasim Sahib, Maulana Bismillah, myself, whenever anybody starts to learn the Quran, the first thing he does, Alif Fatha'a, Ba Fatha'ba, Ta Fatha'ta, Alif Kasra'i, Ba Kasra'bi, Alif Dhamma'u. Rasulullah didn't teach anyone. So how can in every masjid, mashallah, these classes, name me, show me evidence for one class in the time of Rasulullah. It wasn't needed. People just, mashallah, they picked it up. Similarly, tazkiyah in the time of Rasulullah, being in the company of Rasulullah, people would pick it up. With time, as people refined the art of tajweed and recitation, so did refine the art of tazkiyah. Did Rasulullah teach anybody aqeedah? And say this is sahih, da'if, mutawatir, mashallah. No, but now in every university, even Medina, Riyadh, Ummul Qura, that's what they teach you. No sahabi ever learned that way. But this has become a necessity, so we don't say that is bid'ah, that is kufr, that is shirk. So why say when the word aqidah doesn't appear in the Quran, but it's used, mashallah, instantly without any hesitation? So if the word tasawwuf, one brother last year, somebody told me, there's a program on Islam channel, brother, show me the word tasawwuf in the Quran and I'll believe you, and if you can't, then shut up. Brother, show me the word aqidah in the Quran, otherwise similarly shut up. If a word is a problem, then we've got too many problems. We won't be able to go anywhere. It's only a word, and it's a refinement of the field of tazkiyah, which is a fundamental responsibility of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if anybody is trying to attain spiritual enlightenment, or Sufi kafir, Sufi kafir, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Brother, don't worry, kufr is coming right. Because kufr is very quick to do a U-turn. It comes back very quickly to haunt the people who love using the word kufr. Allahu Akbar.
Allahu Akbar. So how what we say things about people, about scholars, if we don't know, we best shut up. We best not say it. Don't be a mufti min al-mufti. Leave the fatwa to the muftis. And even the muftis nowadays, Allahu Akbar, may Allah guide us all. May Allah guide us all, are not so careful. But many youngsters, mashallah, wholesale kafirs. When I was young, you know, coming from Pakistan, and the Pakistanis, because TV and such things weren't very common, so all over the Pakistani newspapers, you would see advertisement for Pakistani films. And there would be two main actors, Sultan Rai and Mustafa Qureshi. Somebody said, be Mustafa Qureshi, Sultan Rai, they've taken a contract for putting people in the Qabristans. Because in Pakistani films, they would go, mashallah, leave a trail of murder, mashallah, bloodshed. So now people have taken the contracts to fill Jahannam, kafir, kafir, kafir. We, Allah sent us to take people out of Jahannam, we are pushing them the other way. Allahu Akbar, very dangerous matter. Very dangerous matter to call another Muslim kafir. Without understanding the issue, without knowing, without thinking, just instantly, hesitantly, many brothers, and I'm not saying this, have you heard these kufr fatwas going around or not?
Yes.
People, mashallah, throwing them around left, right, and center. Allahu Akbar, to make a friend of Allah into an enemy of Allah. Now it says that there are two people Allah has declared war with. Allah has declared it. Allah says, if you got a problem, I'm fighting you. Come, let me sort you out. Allah says. One is mentioned in the Quran, the other is mentioned in a Sahih Hadith in Bukhari. Sahih Hadith. Brother, authentic Hadith. One is in Quran. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu taqullaha wadharu ma baqiya min ar-riba in kuntum mu'mineen. Oh, you people, fear Allah, abandon all dealings and interests. Otherwise, fa illam tafalu. فَاذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. If you don't stop taking interest, then Allah says that this is fighting me and my Rasul. Another person has been mentioned in a Sahih Hadith reported by Imam Bukhari. And the Prophet said, Allah says, مَنْ عَادَ لِي وَلِيًّا فَقَدْ آذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. Anybody who's got any grudge against any of my friends, Allah says, I have already declared a war with them. So calling another man an enemy of Allah, because they say a friend of your friend is also a friend of your friend is dost ka dost bhi or dost ka dushman. An enemy of your friend is also your enemy. Friend of your friend is your friend. So pious people who are friends of Allah, to turn them into enemies, become their enemies, then you are becoming an enemy of Allah. So to call a Muslim a kafir, Allahu Akbar, is a very, very severe thing. Sahaba won't dare do things like that. There are instances. Now we, unfortunately and sadly, due to our negligence and ignorance, where we shouldn't, we do, where we should, then we don't. Then we become chickens. Then we become scared. Because then there are business interests at stake. People working with people. I said, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't throw a man out of Islam because of his sin. And don't call him a kafir because of what he's doing, his bad actions. What determines if a person is a Muslim or a kafir is what's down here. What's down here is testified by the tongue and proven by the amal, but Allah will be the judge. There are many things which people, when they say and when they do, they definitely become kafir. Like Musaylimah Kazzab, he believed in Allah, he believed in Rasulullah, he prayed, he read the Quran. But what did he say? He said, I am a Nabi as well. Rasulullah didn't entertain that. That doesn't give anyone free license to think, doesn't matter what they do, as long as they've said, La ilaha illallah, they are going to remain Muslims. That's not the case either. The actions of a person will not throw him out of Islam, but what he believes, what's down his aqidah, his belief, that's what will govern whether a person remains a Muslim or not. A person who assigns partners to Allah, who does sajda on graves. Many people, they say, our Tabligh brothers, mashallah, Tabligh brothers are Allahu Akbar. You think it's easy going in Tabligh, leaving your homes to go out and learn and preach? You need to try it. And next time when Jamaat comes, they say to you, sit down, brother, who's ready for 3 days, try standing up for 3 days. And then you'll know. It's not easy, but they do. And mashallah, they go, oh, Tabligh is of grave worshippers. You know what a grave worship is? It's shirk, plain, blatant shirk. If someone went and put his head down on a qabr and started making sajda, will he remain a Muslim? He will definitely not remain a Muslim. He'll become a mushrik. And having become a mushrik, whatever he has done in his life, doesn't matter how many prayers he's prayed, how many hajj he's done, how much charity he's given, he might be giving all his income every week into charity for Gaza, Palestine, Somalia, Bangladesh, Iraq, wherever. But Allah doesn't care. Allah warns Rasulullah, لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Oh my beloved Prophet, even if you were to commit shirk, I will ruin all your deeds as well. Not that Rasulullah was ever going to commit shirk. Allah is warning us. Be careful. Keep yourself on the straight and narrow. So to commit shirk is no joke. Very severe thing. Oh, Tablighi, they worship grave of Maulana Iyas, Maulana Yusuf. Because in Nizamuddin, the world headquarters there, and there's a grave of Sheikh Iyas and Sheikh Yusuf. And when they go, they have to bow down. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Anybody who's been, I've been to Nizamuddin, Brother Shah has been to Nizamuddin number of times. I've been as well. There is grave of Maulana Iyas, Maulana Yusuf in the compound, but not in the masjid. It's like you come, this is the masjid area. As soon as you step in from the footpath into the compound, that's the compound area, but not the masjid. Otherwise, there's toilets. Is that masjid downstairs where the toilet is? Is that masjid? Will you pray there? No, you won't pray there. It's in the compound, but that's not the masjid. Similarly, the grave of Maulana Ilyas, Maulana Yusuf is in the compound, but not in the masjid. And the grave is in the back section. As soon as you enter, if you come from that way, that's the Qibla on this side. The grave is on the left side over there, right in the back. And it's concealed. If anybody doesn't know, he won't even know there is a grave there. Oh, Tablighis are grave worshippers. The grave of Maulana Ilyas and Yusuf is there, concealed at the back. Anybody been to Medina? Put your hand up if you've been to Medina. Where is the grave of Rasulullah? And where in the masjid? In the back? Smack in the middle. Not in the middle, right in the front. So do we say all Saudis are grave worshippers? All Salafis are grave worshippers because the grave of Rasulullah is there and they are in Medina? When we keep our mouths shut, you think other people should do the same? Allahu Akbar. Be careful what you say, brother. To call someone a grave worshipper for nothing. Be, the grave of Rasulullah smack in the middle. Grave of Abu Bakr. This ummah, the best man in all the ummahs after Rasul, all the Nabis is who? Come louder. Abu Bakr radiya, don't be afraid to mention his name. You're sitting in a masjid. Abu Bakr, the best man, he was with Rasulullah from the in the cave. He's with Rasulullah in the grave. Will rise with him on the day of Qiyamah. Will be with him on the pond and beyond. So Abu Bakr, may Allah take us all with him. This man in Birmingham, he said, I can't follow Abu Bakr as-Siddiq blindly. I know things about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. I read about things about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, which don't allow me to follow him blindly. Allahu Akbar. What did you read? You must have been reading the books of Shia. The only people ever to open their mouth against Abu Bakr. No Muslim, no decent Muslim in 1400 years has had the nerve to open his mouth when it comes to Abu Bakr, especially Abu Bakr and Umar. Rasulullah said, me and Abu Bakr and Umar, Allah made us from the same clay. Same clay. أنا وأبو بكر وعمر خلقنا من تربة واحدة وفيها ندفن. Me and Abu Bakr and Umar have been created from the same clay, and as they say,
from what you've been created, that's where you will return. And Rasulullah said, that's where we will be buried as well. Abu Bakr is with Rasulullah.
Come on, you might follow another imam. We follow Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. In matters controversial, ambiguous, undefined matters, some people follow Imam Shafi, rahimahullah. Some Imam Malik, some Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, rahimahumullah. Some might follow Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah. But who was the Imam Rasulullah appointed when he was alive?
Did Rasulullah trust him or not?
Rasulullah trusted him enough to leave the reins of his ummah in the hands of Abu Bakr. And this man's got a problem with Abu Bakr. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. And they think, oh brother, this is Tawheed. This is Aqeedah. We don't follow no one blindly. Well, who is Abu Bakr following? When you are behind Abu Bakr, you know, it's not a bad thing to be blind. Many people are, thousands of people are blind in society, every society. If you are blind, do people just sit at home and just pack their bags and just wait to die? They get out and about, what do? They get help from someone who can see. You want to cross the road and you're blind, you're going to stay there, that say, not get out of your house because you're blind? People say, brother, I want to cross the road, can you help me? You find someone who can? Who can see, who's got eyes. So being blind is not bad. But if you are following another blind man, now that's gonna kill you. Huh. We might be blind, yes, but Abu Bakr wasn't blind. Abu Bakr used to see Rasulullah. Abu Bakr used to sit with Rasulullah. And when Rasulullah couldn't come on the Musalla himself, Rasulullah put who? Ibn Taymiyyah bin Baz Albani. Rasulullah put who? Abu Bakr on the Musalla. Did Rasulullah not trust him? What is it? No one in the 14 centuries of Islam has been able to lay a finger, to point a finger, let alone lay a finger, even point a finger at Abu Bakr. Allahu Akbar. And people, on the name, brother, we can't follow no one blindly. We only follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what are you trying to say? Abu Bakr wasn't following Rasulullah? Umar wasn't following Rasulullah? They were following Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what do you say, brothers? This is, you know, this time of fitan and fasad, we have to be very careful. Some people, mashallah, casually they fire away fatwas, and where they should fire away, where they shouldn't, they fire away. Where they should, they keep their mouths shut. When people barking at Abu Bakr and Umar, and there are people, you know, 30, 40 years ago, if you didn't know these issues, didn't matter so much. You lived in Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, Algeria, Somalia, mashallah, in your own communities. Mashallah, brothers, listen to the local khatibs, no problem. Whatever you are, Deobandi, Brelvi, Ali Hadis, whatever. But now, with these channels, internet, everyone's bombarding you with fatwas left, right, and center. A few weeks ago, an old woman rings me. An old Sunni woman. She goes, did Umar really beat up Fatima? You know Fatima? Radiallahu anha, that beloved daughter of Rasulullah. Can any Muslim in his right frame of mind think anything about Fatima radiallahu anha? Umar radiallahu anhu, how can any Muslim ever imagine Umar insulting Fatima radiallahu anha? This old Sunni woman rings me. Did Umar beat up Fatima? I said, calm down, take it easy. What's the matter? Oh, I heard someone was telling me after Rasulullah passed away, Umar went to a house, he banged the door as if Fatima was coming. He threw the door open, she fell down. The whole door fell on her. She was expecting, she had a miscarriage, she was bleeding. Daughter of Rasulullah, Umar beat her up. Where did you hear that? On the telly. Where? This Shia channel. Allahu Akbar. If there was any truth in this story, even 0.001%,
Allah ne akal bhi to di hai ke nahi di?
If someone says to you something, should you not think about it, analyze it, if there was any truth in the story?
Hazrat Fatima was who? Daughter of Rasulullah and wife of who?
Ali. Ali a coward or a brave man?
Weak man, strong man.
He's already proven his strength, his bravery, many battles against many kafirs, and earned praise from Rasulullah, earned praise from Jibreel, and all the Muslims. Ali is no coward. Ali is no weakling.
When Rasulullah passed away, you know how old Ali was?
Because when Rasulullah passed away at the age of 63, Allah blessed him with the nubuwwat at the age of 40. Rasulullah died at the age of 63. How many years is that? 23. Hazrat Fatima only lived 6 months after Rasulullah. She missed him so much. As soon as Rasulullah passed away, she just fell ill. Many people, you know, love their parents. You know, when something happens to them, happens to them. And as a, can you imagine if your father was Rasulullah? Allahu Akbar, how much she would have loved Rasulullah and how much Rasulullah loved her. She only survived 6 months. And same was the case with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr loved Rasulullah so much. After he was a man, she was a woman, he was a man. He barely lasted 2 years after Rasulullah. Allahu Akbar. But anyway, when Allah blessed Rasulullah with wahi and nubuwwat, Hazrat Ali was 10 years old. How old? 10 years old. So after 23 years, how old would he be? 33. When Hazrat Umar passed away, he was 63 years old. After Rasulullah, Hazrat Abu Bakr was Khalifa for 2 years, Hazrat Umar was Khalifa for 10 years. How many years is that? After the death of Rasulullah? 12. So if Hazrat Umar was 63 when he died, 12 years earlier, how old was he? 51. You've been to schools, yeah? I'm supposed to be given a lecture on Deen, not in maths. He was 51 years old. How old was Hazrat Ali when Rasulullah passed away? 33. Hazrat Umar was 51. By normal standards, is 51 young or old? Huh? You know, if just put yourself in a scenario. If you're sitting at home with your family, wife and children, and somebody comes and beats up your wife, what will you do? Give her another one. Is that what you're saying? If you can handle it, what will you do? You'll protect your wife and children. Who is Fatima, daughter of Rasulullah, wife of who? Ali karamallahu wajhahu. And could Ali take care of his wife? He's 33 years old, young man, strong, brave, fearless. He's at home, 51 year old man comes to your house and beats her up. And you just sit there, not do anything. Is that scenario acceptable? If there was any truth in it, who will the blame go on? Ali, where was you when Umar came to beat up the daughter of Rasul? What were you doing? So 51-year-old man comes into the house, beats up the daughter of Rasulullah, mother of Hassan and Hussein, wife of Ali, and Ali doesn't do anything. Is that acceptable scenario? So if anybody says to you, Umar radiallahu anhu beat up Fatima, what should you say? Shut up. Go away. How can Umar, how dare he come into the house of Ali and beat up daughter of Rasulullah? But this kufr, this filth is being bombarded in Muharram into Sunni houses. Sunni houses. Somebody came to Rasulullah, Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu. And how? You see, we only hear stories, we only watch dramas, James Bond, Harry Potter. We don't read the history of our of Rasulullah and his companions, so we won't know who these blessed people were. Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu, when he left Makkah to become Muslim, he left Makkah with Khalid ibn Walid, Usman bin Talha, Amr ibn As. And when Rasulullah was sitting in the masjid, Masjid Nabawi, Rasulullah said, today Makkah has given up its liver. In other words, the
most prominent people in Makkah are now coming to become Muslim. When they reached Medina, one Sahabi saw them. They approached. He wanted to run towards Rasulullah to tell him this good news. Khalid bin Walid, Amr ibn As, Usman bin Talha are coming, Ya Rasulullah, to become Muslim. He thought, Rasulullah will be very happy with me. He met Abu Bakr on the way. Where are you going? I'm going to tell Rasulullah what? After Khalid bin Walid, Usman, Amr bin As, Usman bin Talha are coming. Abu Bakr, just take it easy. Let me go and tell Rasulullah. Hazrat Abu Bakr wanted that honor of pleasing Rasulullah. And Rasulullah was in the Masjid Nabawi. They came and sat next to Rasulullah. They presented their hands to Rasulullah to become Muslim. Rasulullah accepted their hands. Amr bin As then pulled his hands back from the hand of Rasulullah. Ya Rasulullah, do I have an assurance that if I become a Muslim, Allah will forgive all my past sins? Allah will forgive me for everything I've done in the past? Rasulullah said, O Amr, Al-Islamu yahdimu ma kana qablahu. Before Islam, whatever you've done, Allah will wash it all away. Wal-hijratu tahdimu ma kana qablaha. When a person makes hijrah, whatever you've done before is all washed away. Wal-hajju yahdimu ma kana qablahu. When you perform hajj, Allah washes away whatever you've done before. Then Amr said, yeah, now Ya Rasulullah. He used to say, if only it had clicked to me, I only said, Ya Rasulullah, will Allah forgive all my past sins? I should have said, Ya Rasulullah, will Allah forgive my all past and future sins? I would have got that guarantee from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the time of Hazrat Umar, he conquered Egypt. He was, mashallah, a big politician. And he said to Rasulullah once, Ya Rasulullah, Ayyun nasi ahabbu ilayk? Ya Rasulullah, who's the person you love the most? You know what the Prophet said? Aisha. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, thumma man, who then? Abuha, her father. Thumma man, Umar. And then he said, I mentioned a few names, then I stopped because I didn't want to be the last. I didn't want to be the last. So the woman Rasulullah loved the most, her father, amongst all the men Rasulullah loved the most. People have a nerve to call him kafir. People have the nerve to call him kafir. On the internet, a lot of youngsters, they read. They are, alhamdulillah, I'm imam as well, so people ring me, they ask me. On the internet, you go, Yasir Habib, an Arab Shia. His clips, Aisha Hafsa, the daughter of Umar radiallahu anhu. Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr, Hafsa, the daughter of Umar, and they are wives of Rasulullah. The wives of Rasulullah are our mothers. They're who? Allah forbid any Muslim should ever go home and say anything indecent to their mother. If anybody goes home, Allah forbid, never such a day come in the life of a Muslim. Say to your mother, oh woman, you're not my mother anymore. I don't think you're my mother, I don't take you as my mother. Very bad, very sinful. But that won't make him a kafir. She might be his mother, she might not be his mother. In many families, children, people adopt children. So just because other people are calling or encouraging him to call this woman mother, he grows up or she grows up calling him her a mother. She might be his mother, she might not be his mother. And even if she is, being disrespectful to your mother is one of the worst sins a person can commit. But it won't make him a kafir. If anybody says, Aisha is not my mother, Hafsa is not my mother, then that will definitely make him a kafir immediately, because Allah is saying they are your mothers. In the Quran, وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ. And people have the nerve, this Yasir Habib, Arab Shia, he said, Aisha poisoned Rasulullah. Aisha, Hafsa conspired with Abu Bakr and Umar to poison Rasulullah. They curse Abu Bakr, they curse Umar, they curse Aisha, they curse Hafsa, they curse the... Allahu Akbar. Can you imagine? A wife is a very, very sensitive issue. People, a wife, wife's honor, Allah says in the Quran, Hunna libasul lakum antum libasul lahunna. They are your garments, you are their garments. Can you imagine? You know, just for an example, brother, you know, I hope you don't mind. If I say to you about your wife, brother, your wife is a bitch.
excuse the language in the masjid, but this is a matter of iman and kufr. Your wife is right. You know what I mean? How will you feel? What about those people who say about the wives of Rasulullah such filth and kufr? How do you think Rasulullah feels about them? And if a person, they know in their circles, in their majalis, all over the internet, on these satellite channels, they curse Aisha and Hafsa, the wives of Rasulullah. And people, just because they're your friends, and just because, mashallah, you have a meal with them every now and then, your sympathies are not with Rasulullah. Your sympathies are with the enemies of Rasulullah. Where people should be careful, they don't. Where they should, they, brother, don't talk about controversial issues here, brother. This is not controversial issue. This is your iman. This is your iman issue. These are imams. But we don't hear about these things no more. Mujaddid al-Fisani rahmahullah, and he was one of the greatest ulama in Indian subcontinent, one of the greatest saints in the ummah. He's written, when people curse sahaba, wives of Rasulullah, his family, Abu Bakr and Umar, and people just sit back and take it, Allah will not accept your prayer. Allah will not accept your fasting. Allah will not accept your charity. Allah will not accept your hajj. Allah doesn't care about you. If you don't care about the honor of the family of Rasulullah, if you don't care about the, it's not the honor of the family of Rasulullah, this is the honor of Rasulullah. People are friends with Qadianis. People deal with them. They have business transactions with them. They go to their house. They mix with them. They dine with them. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah didn't want to face them. And because this is coming in, brother, don't talk about controversial issues here, bro. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. This is important for you to know who is a kafir, who's not a kafir. Because their zabiha is haram. If you're eating from their meat, then this is haram meat. Although they might read kalima, they might pray, they might do hajj, they read Quran. But in spite of that, because they believe in another imposter, a nabi, they claim him. Hence they are kafir. If anybody marries one of them, a man or a woman, his marriage will not be valid. You can get the Imam of Kaaba to come and perform your nikah, but the nikah will not be valid. You'll be committing zina all your life. If anybody insults Rasulullah's family, his wives Abu Bakr and Umar, doesn't believe this Quran is the complete Quran, because that is what's written in the authentic books of Shia. This is not the complete Quran. That if you marry their woman, your nikah is not valid. You're committing zina all your life. If Allah forbid anybody becomes a Qadiani, or anybody else becomes a murtad, for any matter whatsoever, people say, brother, you know, Islam is not so cheap. But Islam is not so cheap that a man kafir ho jaye. Islam is cheap. When you get married, jab nikah hota hai na, when a person gets married, there is a girl is presented, the boy accepts. You need two Muslim witnesses to be present as well. But for a nikah to be dissolved, you don't need any witnesses. If there's no witnesses, the man goes home, says to his wife, I divorce you. Khalas, that's the end of the issue. Nobody else was present. Nowadays, until a few years ago, people used to send letters. If anybody sent a letter to his wife, I divorce you, the letter didn't reach her. She doesn't know you divorced her. But Allah knows you divorced her. The letter didn't reach her, there was no witness, but she is divorced. Nowadays, people send emails, text messages. Suppose her computer was down, whatever, and she didn't get the text messages, whatever, and but you send it via text
message or email or a message through other means, it didn't reach her.
But still, she is divorced.
A person will not be a Muslim until he declares his shahada.
There was, just before Christmas, in a local garage, there was a brother, mashallah, a mechanic. Some of the brothers working with him were Muslims. They've been working on him. So I went for my MOT and he said, "Mark, you know, Sheikh, I'm going to come and see you in the new year because I'm going to become a Muslim in the new year."
Until he comes to see me or anybody else, he will not be a Muslim because he hasn't declared his faith yet. But if somebody says, after 6 months, I'm thinking about becoming a Qadiani or Ahmadi or whatever.
Not 6 months, he immediately becomes a kafir.
And if anybody utters a word like that which will make him a kafir, his nikah will automatically break. It will break. His wife will no longer remain his wife. If she discovers that's what he said and done, and she has to separate herself from her, from him. Otherwise, she will be committing zina with him.
So, you know, brother, Islam is not, it's what you have in here, brother. That was just a desire.
Brother, you said it because you don't have firm faith in Islam anymore. Had you firm faith, then you wouldn't have uttered these words.
So you have to know the boundaries and limits.
Don't just go around calling people kafir for nothing. But when you know there are matters of kufr, then to hold back is similarly kufr.
These are boundaries, brothers. This is part of our iman. Every Muslim is bound to know this. And if you don't, Allah forbid, Allah forbid. You know, some people leave behind a lot of wealth when they die. If anybody's son has been, Allah forbid, anybody's son should ever become like that. But if he's uttered a word which will make him a kafir, take him out of the fold of Islam, then he cannot leave him a penny even in his wealth, in his inheritance. Because a kafir cannot inherit anything from a Muslim. You can't leave him anything. If there's a kafir, you think he's a Muslim, Qadiani, whatever, and you were getting married, no other Muslim witness, you thought he was a Muslim, but he's a Qadiani, was a witness, your nikah would not be valid because he's not a Muslim witness. You understand? There are a lot of social implications upon these issues. Knowing when not to call anybody a kafir. No Muslim should willingly and knowingly call any Muslim a kafir. But where there is a matter of kufr and iman, then you have to hold your horses, as they say. You have to keep your distance and know, and these are people that you don't associate with. These are people you have to keep your distance. If someone called your wife by a nasty word, will you go around hanging with him, taking him out to dinner? Allahu Akbar, brothers, we should assess, evaluate where our love lies, where our sympathies are, where our loyalties are. May Allah keep us all on the right path, brothers. We pray to Allah that Allah accepts our saying whatever has been said for the pleasure of Allah. May Allah grant us understanding. May Allah grant us love and respect for one another so that we may all live like Muslims and die like Muslims. سبحان الله وبحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك نستغفرك ونتوب إليك اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى واجعل آخرتنا خير من الأولى رب اغفر وارحم وأنت خير الراحمين يا الله we are all sinful and weak you are merciful and powerful يا الله forgive our sins and guide us all to the right path يا الله يا الله guide us and our sons and daughters, our young and our old, our men and our women, Ya Allah, our public and our rulers, wherever there are people suffering in problems, Ya Allah, grant them and grant us all ease and comfort in this world and the life hereafter, Ya Allah. اللهم من أحييته منا فحيه إلى الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه إلى الإيمان وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Thank you.